Luzon, and she wrote many books on cybersecurity, the last one being Cybersecurity for the Developing Countries. She's also the founder of Security in Digital Environments, and she's just come from several conferences around Europe, in Luzon, in London, and we're very, very happy to have her here in Tel Aviv.
Ladies and gentlemen, dear participants, first of all, I would like to take the opportunity to express my most sincere thanks to the organizer of this important conference for having offered me the opportunity to share with you today a number of perspectives and matters for consideration in the field of cybersecurity and of risk management in cyberspace. It seems to me that this conference on cyber warfare is important for several reasons. Not only because of the subject matter and because of the quality of the participants, but also and above all because of the expectation of all members of society, be it at a national, regional or international level. Our work contributions to this debate are framed in the perspective of the durable development of the information society, of the management of risk created by the extensive use or misuse of digital technologies, and of information security at the service of individual, of organization, and of states. Nowadays, it is impossible to address the question of ICT security and of confidence in cybersecurity that concern us without first considering the global context in which this question arises, which is the information society. The protection of information in an interconnected digital world is an issue for all of us. We are surrounded by technology from our birth to our death. Digital technology are a major factor in our civilization, and whether we like it or not, digital technologies and the Internet have brought us firmly into the era of techno-civilization. Information and communication technologies are everywhere, increasingly capable, increasingly invisible, but also increasingly intrusive. The world today is complex, globalized, and above all, dominated by the intensive use of ICT devices, infrastructures, and services. Citizens, organizations, and states are likewise increasingly dependent on ICT infrastructures for everything they need. It is a complex dependency with multiple interdependencies involving several types of actors distributed all over the world. Within this framework, and in order to contribute towards responding to the now global need to manage cyber risk and fight against cyber attack and cyber crime, and by doing so contribute towards providing a little more peace, justice and security in cyberspace and hence in the physical world, we have been drawn toward identifying the need for a global treaty on cybersecurity and cybercrime that I will briefly outline for you, firstly reminding you of its context and its origins, and then mentioning the justification of its existence. I should emphasize the fact that this initiative is a proposal with which I am closely involved, but of which I am not the alone creator. The proposal for a global treaty on cybersecurity and cybercrime, a contribution for peace, justice and security in cyberspace, emerged from a long period of international cooperation of which the origins could be found in the work that I undertook with the Norwegian judge Stein Scholberg within the framework of the International Telecommunication Union, the Global Cybersecurity Agenda. In 2009, Judge Scholberg and I published the first proposal for an international treaty in the form of a book, the second edition of which appeared in January this year. By way of background, the ITU launched in May 2007 the Global Cybersecurity Agenda for a framework within which the international response to growing challenges to cybersecurity could be coordinated. In order to assist the ITU in developing this strategic proposal, a high-level expert group was established. More than 100 of this group were members of this group were nominated by the ITU Secretary General with due consideration of both geographical diversity and range of expertise to ensure multi-stakeholder representation. Judge Stein Scholberg from Norway was the Ashleigh chairman, and I was co-leader of two international working groups. In this context, we delivered in November 2008 the Global Strategic Report that includes recommendations on local measures, technical and procedural measures, organizational structures, capacity building, and international cooperation. The ITU Global Cybersecurity Agenda provides the essential architecture to set up effective national and international measures to encourage countries to develop national cybersecurity programs and international cooperation. It should be seen as a first and important step toward a global cybersecurity approach. Of course, the rule of ethics, of good behavior or good practices are as important in this domain as they are everywhere else. Nevertheless, we know very well that good intentions of all kinds, like all non-binding recommendations, are of little use when confronted by, on one side, the political and economic stakes related to the management of cyberspace and digital technologies, and, on the other side, the reality of the criminal world, and finally, and above all, the fact that cyberspace should be considered as a universal asset. Many commentators agree that cyberspace should be considered as a fifth common domain of nature, in the same way as and following the land, the air, the sea, and space. Cyberspace, like the other domains, have a great need for coordination and cooperation among all nations. Nowadays, there is a real and urgent need for international agreement for a coherent and global approach to deal with cybersecurity and cyber attack issues. Organization, business, and state face a significant risk in relation to the inappropriate disclosure, misappropriation, and destruction of data and information. And such incidents, when viewed at a macroscopic level, can be viewed as posing a potential threat, not just to the competitiveness or reputation of a business, but also at a national level to public safety, national security, or democracy itself. These issues cannot be addressed effectively on a purely local level. In the same way as the Convention, as the Kyoto Protocol is an international agreement linking to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, a global protocol on cybersecurity and cybercrime should be seen as a truly global approach to reducing risk and threat in cyberspace. It should provide the essential architecture for setting up effective national and international measures to counter cyber attacks and should include a clear definition of acceptable and unacceptable behaviors and of the framework of necessary for control. Cyber warfare, defensive or offensive computer warfare, whichever name is used, is related to issues of economic and or military conflicts and raise, among others, the question of individual, national, global and international responsibilities, the question of international collaboration and the question of private and public partnerships. At the same time, reliable and complete statistics related to cyber attacks or cybercrime are rare. That could lead to over or underestimating the risk-based need for cybersecurity. All this contributes to generating insecurity and fear, which makes the provision of effective and efficient security measures more difficult. In any case, national and international strategies should exist not only to respond to cyber attack, thus defining reactive measures to be undertaken after an attack, but should also consider proactive measures in order to avoid security breaches and to prevent unsolicited incidents. This could be done, for example, through developing an appropriate cybersecurity culture and diplomacy, by reducing vulnerabilities that could be exploited to attack systems, In fact, by taking into consideration in a systemic way all those factors that can be lead to, for example, deviant behaviors, crises, acts of retaliation or crime, and by harnessing complementary and coherent measures in a holistic and global way. But if we believe that cyberspace can be increasingly considered as a global economic and military battleground, where all kinds of cyber conflicts can arise, reflecting all kinds of political and economic competition, it is time to frame what is acceptable or not on a common and approved basis and to set up an effective international instrument for controlling it. This is because without a common understanding and international agreement, it will be impossible to set up effective security measures to correctly protect ICT resources, including critical infrastructure and vital infrastructure, to fight against cybercrime and to preserve fundamental human rights. We should not forget that without a strong commitment between all actors and involved stakeholders at national and international level, it will be impossible to address cybersecurity needs at national and international level. A global treaty or a set of treaties on cybersecurity and cybercrime at the level of the United Nations should be the framework for peace, justice and security in cyberspace. An international agreement should facilitate the development of a global strategy to deter cyber threats from any direction. The process of working toward a national nations treaty should help develop a common understanding of all aspects of cybersecurity among countries at various stages of economic development. All stakeholders need to come to a common understanding of what constitutes cybercrime, cyberwarfare, and other forms of cyber threat. This is a prerequisite for developing national and international solutions that harmonize cybersecurity measures. This kind of common understanding will also help to reduce the divide between the perception of cybersecurity in developed and in developing countries. Because criminal conduct in cyberspace is global by nature, it requires global harmonization of cybercrime legislation. It requires effective international justice and police cooperation and a real will to do this. A global treaty at the level of the United Nations should establish the principle that serious crime against peace and security perpetrated through the Internet and cyberspace are crimes under international law, whether or not they are punishable under national law. We strongly believe that the most serious crime in cyberspace should be defined and handled under an international law. Nevertheless, we can also note that the Council of Europe Convention on Cybercrime that finally entered into force in July 2004 was an historic milestone in the combat against cybercrime. This convention can constitute only an example of a regional initiative, and many countries prefer to make use of the convention only as a reference and nothing more, because it is and always be a European convention. In other words, it is necessary within a global framework at the level of the United Nations to establish a treaty, including the broadly accepted standard and principle in the Convention, but with certain important additional provisions. Our book recommends that countries outside Europe could use the Convention as a guideline or as a reference for developing the international legislation by implementing the standards and principles it contains, in accordance with their own legal system and practices, with certain exceptions and additional provisions. Since the publication of the first edition of our book, we have had the opportunity to present the idea of the framework of an international treaty related to cybersecurity and cybercrime to several UN agencies and at conferences in different countries all the world, such as the United States, Japan, China, Brazil, Switzerland, Norway, France, Egypt, the United Kingdom, and now in Israel. The initiative has also been the subject of many scientific and wide audience publications and has resulted in numerous interviews with different media, both national and international. At the moment, we are working with the East-West Institute, an international think tank where a cybercrime legal working group chaired by Judge Scholberg, and of which I am a member, was created last year. The group has the objective of advancing discussion of a treaty or a set of treaties on cybersecurity and cybercrime. The members are independent, non-political, non-governmental experts in this field, working on recommendations that will promote cooperation and serve the global community. As I have previously mentioned, the internet and cyberspace have become, at a global level, component of the civilizations that we will leave to future generations as part of their heritage. For this reason, it is our duty and our responsibility, both individually and collectively, to determine together the common values that we wish to promote and see respected internationally. It will take time to build a cyberspace, the security and reliability of which we can rely upon. And this project will require many kinds of resources and skills. Such a project will be based not only upon dedicated technology and management procedures and a specific legal framework that is enforceable nationally and compatible at an international level, but also upon means of governance and control that are recognized and verifiable internationally. This mean will need to be developed and implemented with and to the benefit of all the participants in the global use of the Internet, with a particular input from the giant of the Internet that contributes so much to its success. Certain fundamental principles will also need to be identified, adopted, and widely recognized by the international community, following the example of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights in 1948. It will not be a simple matter to define successfully this commonly accepted value, given the differences in country, cultures, and economic and political stakes. The creation of a global treaty on cybersecurity and cybercrime will doubtless be a long process. This is why it is urgent to start now to implement a mechanism that will facilitate an international dialogue so that it will be completed in a time frame that corresponds to the global stakes in play. Even bearing in mind the difficulty confronting the creation of such a treaty, which of course might well not be respected, as my example of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights illustrates, it will constitute an instrument to be deployed against bad behavior, be it by individuals, organizations, or states. As a result, it should contribute toward avoiding a drift away from common values, or at least highlight divergences and allow, where appropriate, compensations through legal channels. During the second Worldwide Cybersecurity Summit in London last week, Sir Michael Reich, the chairman of British Telecom Group, stated that it was, and I quote, critical to try to move towards some sort of cyber technology non-proliferation treaty. This comment reflects the same need for the international community to find solutions that will allow cyber risk to be restricted to an acceptable level. This could prove to be insufficient, however, as it reduces cyberspace and information technologies to the statue of tools of the military world that could be used as weapons. But the frontier between the military and civilian worlds are not clear. The same technologies are used and the Internet is the same for everyone, from the very youngest to the most senior users, for economic development, for massive fraud, for cyber espionage, or as cyber weapons. If we take as an analogy the 1968 Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons, a treaty the benefits of which were no longer under discussion in spite of the continued difficulty in its applications, this treaty was of no use in preventing the nuclear catastrophe at Fukushima last March, which was not the result of military action, but on the other hand, an organizational structure that the International Atomic Energy Agency has shown its value in the coordination of the monitoring of the catastrophe and in the creation of the security measures which followed it. Applied to cyberspace, an equivalent structure should exist in order to promote the safe, secure, and peaceful public use of information and communication technologies. This analogy to nuclear weapon and power station, which is, I admit, both daring and limited, should not cover up the need to implement a global and holistic approach to addressing the problem relating to cybersecurity, to cyberspace, and that justifies the adoption of a treaty that recognizes both the military dimension and all others. Cyberspace is of benefit to all kinds of criminal whose activity, such as money laundering or human trafficking, for example, will have impact on both the military and civilian domain. But even above this specific consideration, is it acceptable that human rights are not respected in cyberspace? I am convinced that a global treaty on cybersecurity and cybercrime should contribute to more peace, justice and security in cyberspace and in real life. So that was the idea I would like to share with you today, and I thank you for your attention.